judge, the next city council representative, a whole generation of entrepreneurs, your new school superintendent, your new principal, and other leaders whose decisions will impact our community and our lives. You are creating their perception of San Antonio. Many respected leaders have made monumental decisions in our community. If we look around, we can see these monuments of progress. There's the Toyota plant, for example, in South Carolina. Windsor Park Mall, transforming into the headquarters for Rackspace, a nationally based cloud computing company. USAA, a major national insurance provider. The old Pearl Brewery, which is becoming the cutting edge of San Antonio's culinary scene. And then there's UTSA, evolving from a young commuter campus to a school on a trajectory towards national recognition as a tier one institution. The architect who has shaped UTSA is someone I have had the privilege of calling my boss for the past 18 years, Dr. Ricardo Romo. As president of the University of Texas San Antonio, Dr. Romo, who is now retired, ushered in a tremendous series of changes at UTSA. For example, there was, during his tenure, a 50% growth in enrollment. He ushered in programs of excellence in cybersecurity, brain health, data analysis, anthropology, music, teacher preparation. Under his leadership, UTSA was awarded the prestigious Community Engagement Classification, which is reflective of the university's enormous engagement with San Antonio. These investments are paying dividends as today UTSA Roadrunners are becoming CEOs, top scientists, seasoned employees, elected officials across the city, the state, and the nation. But Dr. Romo is also a nationally recognized historian, deeply rooted in his community and well-versed in its heritage. His work shows an honor and appreciation of the past. He's an accomplished photographer, a patron and collector of Latino arts. With vision and imagination, this afternoon, Dr. Romo will help us catch a glimpse of the future in his presentation entitled Bridging the Gap and Building an Education Community. Please help me welcome to the podium Dr. Ricardo Romo.
Well, good afternoon and welcome to one of the great campuses of the Southwest. Happy to be here with you. I began my teaching career in middle school in Austin, Texas. Wanted to run track, so I went out to California and taught high school for 3 years. They made the mistake of telling me that my credentials from UT Austin in teaching did not meet California standards, and that I would have to take more classes in California history. And initially, it was a little disturbing that I'd go back to school after finishing my degree. So I went back to school. Next thing I knew, I had a master's degree. And I was recruited to go teach in college. And I said, well, okay. The high school asked me to get more credentials, and now I got credentials, and college wants me to teach there. So I did that. And when I got to the college, they said, you know one thing about California State University systems? If you want any job security, you're going to have to get a PhD. I said, really? Okay. So I said, well, I'll teach. And when I was teaching, I went and got my PhD at UCLA. Well, that, of course, meant that now I got recruited nationally to go elsewhere. I left the college. They had told me I had to get a PhD, otherwise I couldn't stay there. So that was strange wrong to get there, and I got ended up in Austin, Texas, and I saw history for 20 years, and then came here and was here 18 years. So I think one of the, it's ironic I am talking about several things I want to address today, including the what can we do to get students ready to think about college. But let me talk about you for a second. I spent 2 hours this morning on a phone call. I'm on the board of the Air University, which includes the training of all officers. And either the Air Force Academy or Lackland or Randolph and around the country. And they said, this is what we're thinking. We're thinking that if you want to be an officer, if you want to be a leader, we will require you to have done some teaching. You can teach in cybersecurity, you can teach in leadership, you can teach on how to fix tanks, but you have to have taught, because if you don't teach, then you're not, for us, going to be the right kind of leader. That was amazing. I mean, this is the strongest support I've ever heard for the teaching profession. So I thought, start with that. Let me mention a couple of things. One is, what does learning and discovery mean? And I'm gonna approach it from some good things I've heard while at UTSA. So we had a CEO from Toyota, and Toyota had just gotten here, and we're all excited, and we want some of our graduates to go work at Toyota. So we invited the CEO to come speak. And he said, okay, I will be happy to tell you the secret to our success, why we think we're better than any other company in the world. And the reason is we hire people who are problem solvers. We hire people who have good communication skills. We hire people and say, this is real important, value teamwork, because everything we do at the plant is about teamwork. And we tell people, if you can demonstrate that you are willing to work really hard, then you're going to be successful with us. And one final point, this is real important. We're big believers in continuous improvement. So if you're going to be here, you're going to have to continuously learn. So I thought, well, gosh, this makes my job easier. You know, only thing I can add here is critical thinking. It's just kind of combined here with problem solving. They say, if you're not a problem solver, you're not going to work well at the line or in the management office. You've got to be a problem solver. And by the way, my belief in problem solving was, don't come to me with the problem. Come to me with a solution. And I think of students too can do that. If you come get them ready, don't come with me, I don't know where I'm going to go to college. Come to me with, I have selected these 5 colleges. I'm thinking, what do you think? And maybe you get something going versus, hand me on a plate the 2 colleges I should go to. That's not our job. So let me move on to, by the way, my bonus to these discussions of learning and discovery as an introduction, my bonus thought is I would add civic engagement. I would say it is ever more important today to learn history, to learn political science, to know something about our founders, which I am pleased to see that you guys have given some workshops in that area, and to learn about how to preserve our democracy. And you can't do that if you don't understand how we got a democratic system in the first place. So I know you're there, but our students need to do that as we move them along. So one of the things that I did was to establish focus group meetings with students. And initially, in the focus group meetings, we always had quick responses to, we can do that, or we can't do that. But I got to really discussing with them, why do we need that? what's the purpose of that? And we had some good, you know, why do we need a new dorm? We don't have enough dorms. This is what I know. There is no demand for dorms. That's what they tell us. This actually happened. There is no demand for dorms because the dorms company told us there is no demand. The students went away, we're going to show you that there is a demand. They went out there and did a survey on campus and basically demonstrated that if we open up some new dorms, there would be 800 people sign up. That discussion led to a decision to put $150 million worth of dorms because the students press, because the students were engaged in critical thinking. So I felt that a lot of what I did and what I learned about how to run the place was coming from focus groups with students initially, then with staff, and then with faculty. And so in the focus group, you would say, what's the problem here? We're not doing very well in attracting students from the community colleges. I remember one discussion. We don't do well because we don't have any scholarships for students at community colleges. Didn't know that. So we created a scholarship. We had to go out and raise some money. We created scholarships, and for the first time now, can you imagine, we've been in existence almost 50 years, and last year was the first year, that we gave any scholarship to somebody coming out of community college. It makes any sense. We're the logical. Now, so I sat down with my nephew last night, you know, who came by to visit because I had a little techie problem. He's 16 years old. And what he discovered was that my new computer had a virus. And I would have never figured that out. I really wouldn't have. I know the problem, but I didn't know what it was. So anyway, so he came by, and he's a nice, great kid. I'm very proud of him because at 16, he got selected to skip his senior year and go to USC on a full scholarship. I have, in all my teaching, in 50 years in education, I have never met a kid who said, you can skip. You don't need to be. You got enough kind of credits and everything to value. He says, I'm not as smart as my brother who made a perfect score on the math SAT. And like he got like 30 points less or something. I'm not going to feel sorry for you, kiddo. So I said, I got to give a talk tomorrow. What can I say about you guys getting ready to go to college? He said, well, here's what the teachers can help me with. He said, the teachers can help me create the picture. Create the picture of who I can be, who I will become. Not who I am, but who I will be. I said, okay, we're going to get to that in a minute. So I said, you're telling me the students want some help with their vision, statements? Oh, heck yeah. He said, but more than that, we want teachers to help us identify our potential. Now, I was real surprised when he told me what his deal was, because his brother is his older brother is like his dad, my brother. Brilliant in math. My brother's an engineer. I went to Lanier High School, community college, tech trade school, and then over 16 years he finished his engineering degree. He was one smart kid, but he was working at Sony. He was busy. So the young boy, I said, so who discovered your potential? Well, my teachers told me I was a really good writer. I said, what's going to be your major? He says, writing. I'm going to go to USC that has the best film school and learn to be a better writer. I said, wow. And so it's the teachers, not yourself. He said, when the teachers told me, this is a good essay. You got it down. You know the stuff. He said, I realized that I was really better at writing than at math. I'm not going to be like my dad. My dad would love it if I was an engineer. Because, and it surprised me. I wasn't sure. He said, I want to go into the ministry. I will get my four-year degree, and I will work with young people the rest of my life. I said, wow. It was kind of moving. Like, you know, thinking that, but he didn't sort this out totally by himself. Now, yes, there were some family influences there. His mother volunteers to work in Guatemala as a nurse every year, and maybe some family influences, but, you know, ultimately, it wasn't any peer pressure. It was ultimately people that he went to without thinking about this. So that's what we do as teachers. We mentor, we guide, we counsel, we advise. Sometimes we give folks some really good ideas. I know that if not for my middle school teacher, I would not have gotten into track. He discovered my potential. He says, "You are the best runner I've ever seen." And I won 3 state championships, so all in high school before he knew it. I mean, he watched me through high school. But before he knew I had that talent, he said, "You're the best runner." And I said, "No." "So how come I can't make the baseball team?" He says, "You're not good at baseball." Rats, I wanted to be. I wanted either baseball or basketball. So don't try basketball. So I went to track. And so that's what we do. We're guided by our friends who are our teachers. Students look to have a friendship. Students look to have someone they can believe in. So one of the things I was asked to address was what can we do about that achievement gap? The achievement gap. Well, it's a lot of work, folks, and you all can do it, but it's going to take a lot of work. You won't see necessarily progress by next year. You'll see it over a decade. You'll see it over 5 years. But here's what just talking to students about this, I would ask them, "How did you get to be student body president?" You know, I went to lunch 2 weeks ago with a former student body president who's having a great, great career. He's graduated, went to the University of Pennsylvania Law School. And things are going really his way. He's got a summer job working for a judge, which is perfect because these internships make a big difference. Internships, I'm gonna say later, are key. Mentorship, internships. So, first of all, when I ask some of these folks, "You're a leader. How did you? What the benefit? What people say to you that help you?" Is that, "Well, early on, I was lucky. People built my confidence. People built my self-esteem. People gave me advice like reading can be as much fun as video games." Didn't believe it, but it turned out to be true. Now, among Hispanics, by the way, one of the things that they attribute to be the biggest obstacle, the number one obstacle for Hispanics moving on to college or doing other things, is a lack of self-esteem and self-confidence. So that's important. Now, when we tackle the achievement gap, we gotta make it to where students believe that they can do stuff, that they can do math, they can do science, and why it is important. So right now, I'm working on some writing. My absolute love is art. And I'm writing an article about borderland artists. And I found in the first 3 interviews I did, I called people up and interviewed them for an hour and said, "You know, I think we got it all covered." And turns out I don't. Call them back the next day and learn some more. But I remember the very first artist I talked to was born in El Paso. And he said, I said, "Well, when did you get interested in art?" He said, "I was always drawing." And I said, "And?" He says, "In the 5th grade, a teacher told me, 'Wow, this is great stuff. If you do one of these things for the class, I'll pay you. I'll pay you a dollar.'" This guy's my age, so he's, a dollar back then was a lot of money. So they said, "Fine." I said, "Wow." I said, "But in high school, no encouragement." "So you have all this talent and no one encouraged you?" I said, No one thought I had a non talent. "So what'd you do?" I said, "Well, I became a machinist, worked in the machine shop." And then went to school at night, community college, went to school at night. And then before I knew it, I went to Texas Western and got a degree, and an art degree, and then went to New Mexico State and got another art degree, and became a teacher. His whole life, he was a high school teacher. By the way, this person I'm talking about is got spondylitis. So he said, well, I don't think that name sounds familiar to me. If you go to the convention center, there is no bigger piece of art at the convention center than his work of the community of El Segundo Barrio of El Paso, Texas. By the way, his entire career is built on the subjects of his community, Segundo Barrio, which is one of the poorest. It's right next to the Rio Grande. And it's a very poor community, and he taught there for up until last year at La Bui, that's what he called it, La Bui High School. And all his subjects are his students. So he would talk to people, hey, I think I want to paint you. And so he's got all these students. But all the students he has, by the way, he defines them as, they got an attitude. So when you see, go to the convention center, you have permission to leave in the lake in a little while and go there and then the river walk. But so go to the convention center and you'll see this giant painting of about three people from Barrio El Segundo, and it was his portrait. So I was talking to God's father, and he said, you know, I'm thinking how things would have been different here. I'm sure you thought, I needed to get going in my career, man. I didn't need to be a machinist. And but he struggled with it. Community college just gave him his opportunity in East LA. He came back. Now, one thing about encouraging people to do things is they take off. So I had practiced my interviews with a good friend named Sebastian. Now Sebastian has got the biggest piece of art in the whole city. The biggest, there's nothing bigger in his art. The torch of friendship, right by the Alamo, right in front of the old Jaskies. Not a few blocks from here. So if you go there and you realize that to accomplish this was not just about creating art, it was about being absolutely brilliant in geometry and math. So he loved geometry as a kid. He's always trying to figure out things. And he's actually lectured on math and geometry. Now Sebastian put the torch of friendship, and that's how we became friends, no pun intended. I went to see him put it up, and they actually had it wrong. Had a team put it naturally. They would have topped over it. But he came in, corrected it, and we thought this guy's smart. And so he's so one of the things we did for him was we connected him with Dr. Miguel Yacaman, who's a professor of physics at UTSA, who has charge of the electron magnetic microscope. Those of you who are in this field of science know that that is the most powerful microscope in the world. It is the only microscope that you can see the atom. So he went over there and looked at the particular pieces of gold and rocks and found that they had interesting geometrical sculptures that had never been seen by any artist before. So now he's kind of doing some paintings of the geometrical sculptures that he identified of the molecular structure. Pretty amazing. So these guys follow that rule of continuous learning. We're not done just because I make money. By the way, he does really well. His sculptures are enormous, they're all over the place. He's got sculptures in about 10 different countries. But he's not satisfied. I can build a sculpture tomorrow. Thinking, this guy's offered me a chance to look at atoms. I kind of wonder if there's anything interesting about them geometrically formed, and they are. Now, continued about the achievement gap. Start early, as early as we can, to build this young people's confidence, that they can do stuff, that they can paint, that they can write, that they can do math. The other thing is empower yourself to help your school. Empower yourself to help your district. Empower yourself to help your community. So, for example, all of us should engage, you know, and I do it when I go to Fox Tech, engage the school leadership. How do we compare in SAT takers? I asked that question in my high school, Fox Tech, down the street. All right, Tech Line, as we call it. I asked that question, and I found out that only 20% of the students took an SAT test. That's to say that 80% had no plans of going to college. Across town, I went into schools, 88% of students took the SAT. So basically is, come on, guys. You know, you see Lanier, they're a little higher than we are. You see Brackenridge, the Eagles, they're higher than we are. Let's do something. So that's what our job is. So our job is to encourage young people, to engage the community, to find out if we, as a school, are doing everything we can, and let these folks know, with the knowledge we have, 66% of the new jobs in the next 5 years will require a college degree. 66%. So when you have 66% of students not interested yet in going to college, that's too much. I asked my nephew, any hints, anything I am, what helped you? He said, what really is interesting about me is that it's not a question of whether or if I would go to college. The only question my whole life was, where? The only question was where. And I think we have to instill that in every single one of our students. And let them decide later on, I'm going to be one of that one-third of the kids that won't go because I got a good job. Mom and daddy got a lot of money. I don't need college. But in the meantime, let's basically be thinking that college should be for everybody. College, because if not, too many of our students end up in dead-end jobs, low-skilled jobs, no job security, no pensions, no perks, barely get vacations, and then after a while, they move you out. Now, you know those kind of jobs because all of us go to fast food places and you see those poor kids, and that's what it is. Now, some of them are working to pay college loans. Okay, so that's part of my, now we move into the closing here. Not closing so much, but ooh. All right, real quick things. Five essential takeaways. As I noted, college requires SAT, ACT, get kids to take it. Get them to take it in the ninth grade. Get them to take it early as they can, pre-SAT. Secondly, college requires that you do well in high school. Top 25% for UTSA, top 8% for UT Austin. So what we expect of ourselves is push yourself, ask people to push themselves to finish and do well in school. A, Bs, and Cs, no Ds and no Fs. All right. College requires finances. Learn about financial literacy. Learn about scholarships. Learn about grants. Learn about work study. Learn about loans. College requires lots of pre-planning. So you got to do the tours. Do they have dorms? You got to do the tours. What's the situation on how do I get to school? Do I drive? I take the bus? Do I live on campus, off campus, apartments, and so forth? College, many colleges, top colleges, will look at your complete resume, students. So make it look good. Get on the debate team. My son, I said, you got to do something, son. You know, he said, I don't want to track that. And I said, well, that's a big disappointment to me. But okay. And he said, I'll play basketball. I said, no, you're not a good basketball player. I'm just quoting my coach, I told him. I said, but he did debate, and he went to the state championship in debate, and then he did rowing, because that was the only sport that would take him. disappointing. But bless his heart, he got into Stanford, you know. he did well. Okay. Three more things on the takeaway. Tell your students, prepare for change. It's going to be a new life. When you get to college, you're on your own. No one's going to wake you up. No one's going to ask you if you went to class. No one's going to scold you. You're on your own. You're going to pass on your own. You're going to flunk on your own. It's better if you pass because you're spending money. Because we've already did the finances here, folks, and it costs anywhere from $10,000 to $50,000 to go to school. As I noted, become financial literate. Lots of money involved here. And the next one, number three, is prepare to manage your time. Prepare to manage your time. That's going to be one of the hardest things. How much time on this course? How much time on that course? Don't study online for the test the next day. That's not a good family management time. And get ready for success. But don't let it just mean that that's the end. When I graduated from college, when my son graduated from college, when my daughter graduated from college, my son thought, I'm done. I'm going to go work in affordable housing, help people get housing. After a couple of years, he realized he could do better if he had a law degree. 3 years later, he said, I think I'm going to go to law school. Good decision. Did he make it out of college? No. My daughter got out of college. She said, I want to be a college teacher. I want to teach history. And applied, got into Harvard, got her PhD there, and now is a college teacher. And she went straight. She knew what she wanted to do. She had her passion. And that's what sometimes that happens with folks. Sometimes it happens easily. Sometimes it doesn't happen easily. But the one thing I want to close with is that people don't really care how much you know. People care how much you care. People want to know that you care. And if all of us show a little caring, a little compassion, a little empathy, a little, I want to help you, I hope I can, then this group of kids coming through here, San Antonio, Villama, will be better. Better students, better citizens, better community people. God bless you for all the work that you do. Thank you so much for having me.
Dr. Romo's contribution he's made to San Antonio, to the university, and the community. Our next person.